Turn to 359, number 359. And as we sing this song, let's ask ourselves if we're trying to find satisfaction in anything other than Jesus tonight. Satisfied, number 359.
My life long I had panted for a drink from some cool spring that I hoped would quench the burning of the thirst I felt within. Hallelujah, I have found him whom my soul so long has craved. Jesus satisfies my longing.
Number 375, number 375, and as we sing this song, let's praise the Lord that all of our guilt and all of our penalty for all of our sins has been done away with through the blood of Jesus Christ. 375.
Saved by the blood of the crucified one, now ransomed from sin and a new work begun. Sing praise to the Father and praise to the Son. Saved by the blood of the crucified one. Save, save. My sins are all pardoned. My guilt is all gone. Save, save. I'm saved by the blood of the crucified one. Saved by the blood of the crucified one. The angels rejoicing because it is done.
As we turn back or turn over forward to number 390, number 390, and in this song, let's praise the Lord in our hearts that we never have to be far from or away from him. We can constantly be abiding with him because he never leaves us, he never forsakes us, he will never leave us lonely. 390. Thank you. Great singing. Let's take our Bibles now and open to the book of 1 Peter as Joey Crandall comes to bring us our first message.
Good evening. All right. Like Mr. Loran said, we're going to be in 1 Peter. We're going to be in chapter 4 this evening. We're going to read the first six verses. It's 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. 'Forasmuch then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. For he that hath suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lusts of men, but to the will of God. For the time past of our life may suffice us to have wrought the will of the Gentiles, when we walked in lasciviousness, lusts, excessive wine, revelings, banquetings, and abominable idolatries, wherein they think it strange that ye run not with them to the same excess of riot, speaking evil of you. Who shall give account to him that is ready to judge the quick and the dead? For this cause was the gospel preached also to them that are dead, that they might be judged according to men in the flesh, but live according to God in the Spirit. Before I start my message, let's go ahead and come to the Lord in prayer. Lord, thank you for this evening. Thank you for the ability to read your word. Lord, I pray that you use me to speak your words and help it to come across the way that you need it to. Give us all peace and help us to enjoy reading and learning from you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so the main point that I want to make is this. We should live our lives following the will of God and not the lust of men. We should live our lives following the will of God and not the lust of men. We should appear differently from everyone else in the world. Okay, no, so there's a lot of information in just these six verses alone. So, in order to understand it better, let's read it a little bit slower and dissect it a little bit. In verse 1, it says, "Forasmuch then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh." It says it right there, Christ suffered. And we know he suffered to the point of his death. It also says to arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. We should live our life following Christ's example. We should expect to suffer. And because of our sin, we should expect to suffer until the point of our death. It also says in verse 1, "For he that suffered in the flesh, hath he ceased from sin." Well, that explains that after we die, we're going to cease from sin as long as we're a Christian, because we're no longer in our sinful bodies. And then it goes on to verse 2, "That he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh." That's once again referencing us as Christians living our life, that we should no longer live the rest of our life to the lust of men, but we should live it to the will of God. And then it bounces back to how we used to live our lives. Who here has heard the phrase, the black sheep of the family? Well, think about us in that perspective. But we're actually reversed. In a world of black sheep, you're a white sheep. They're going to think that you're the strange one, not them. And verse 3 is just proof of that, because it explains, in time past, when we were not saved, our life may suffice us to have wrought the will of the Gentiles. That word wrought there just means to do or to perform. And that's just doing the things of the Gentiles. When we walked in lasciviousness, that's filthy conversation. Lusts, excessive wine, getting drunk. Revelings, that's actually rioting, throwing a fit because you don't get your way. Banquetings, serious partying, drugs, alcohol, and abominable idolatries. That's idol worship, which is worshiping something in the place of worshiping God, worshiping something that isn't Him. And that verse right there leads into verse 4, wherein they think it strange. They're not going to fully understand you. For example, when you go out to a restaurant after you get your food, what do you do? Do you pray? Well, what about when you're around unsaved friends? Do you pray then? Well, how about at work or at school? Do you pray? Well, do you actually feel strange in those situations? Well, you should. It's not the norm. And if you do feel strange, that's a good point as to you're following the will of God by being thankful for what He has given you. Well, in the movie Narnia, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, there's a scene where the three siblings are walking into camp to get to Aslan. Everyone else around them stops what they're doing, looks them dead in the eye, and just stares at them. It gets so bad to the point that Susan is like, "Why are they all staring at us?" And Lucy, of course, responds, Lucy's the youngest, she responds, "Well, maybe they just think you look funny." That's exactly how the world looks at you. You're doing something that they don't understand. They're going to think you're weird. Or they're even going to think that you're silly, as it says in verse 4, wherein they think it's strange that ye run not with them. To the point, it says they're going to speak evil of you. But then it leads into verse 5. Who shall give account to him that is ready to judge the quick and the dead? What? Who is the who? Well, of course, the people who are speaking evil of you. They are going to give account to who? To him that is ready to judge. That's Christ. They have to give account to Christ for what they're saying about you. And of course, Christ is ready to judge the quick and the dead. Quick right here is just another word for the living. And dead, of course, means the dead. Verse 6, it explains why all of this needs to happen. For this cause, well, what cause? Living for the will of God. For this cause was the gospel preached also to them that are dead. No, that doesn't mean you're going to see Pastor Lee walking down the middle of the cemetery preaching to the dead. Dead here is actually a different kind of dead. It's not the physical dead. It's actually the spiritual death. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 5, it says, even when you were dead in sin. hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved. So that dead in verse 6 is the spiritual dead. But in Ephesians 2:5 it says, after God has given you grace, you're no longer dead. You are alive. And so now let's reread that. For this cause was the gospel preached unto them that are dead spiritually, that they might be judged, the Christians, so that the Christian might be judged according to men in the flesh. It says so right there, you will be judged by your peers. But this cause was also that you live according to God in the Spirit. You may be like, okay, that's a great, that's a lot of information. What am I to do with all this? How am I going to apply this to my life right now? Think about that brother or that sister that has walked away from Christ. Think about that coworker or that friend you just can't stand being around. Well, how about that neighbor that likes to drink, or you know, that likes to swear? Well, should we just walk away and let them live their life the way that they want to? Did Christ? Christ was never popular with what he was preaching. He was preaching the truth, and he was so unpopular, it led to his death. And what was his whole reasoning? Well, what does it say in John 3:16? For God so loved the world. Love. You can't do anything without it. So how do we follow in Christ's footsteps and show his will? By showing love. Love that person. The truth is never easy to hear, especially when you're the one that's being convicted. So next time you get the feeling that you need to just smack somebody upside the head with the Bible, remember, do it in love.
Let's stand for a moment and stretch our legs and turn to 339, number 339. Thank you. All right, I'm going to pick up right where Joey left off. So we're going to be still in 1 Peter chapter 4. I'm going to start in verse 7 and going through verse 11. So I want to read those, before I read them. The message that I'm giving today is titled Christian Roles in the Church, and it's going to focus on hindrances, duties, and the reasoning. So let's read the Word of God. But the end of all things is at hand. Be therefore sober and watch unto prayer. And above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sins. Use hospitality one to another without grudging. As every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another, as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen. All right, so the first part that I want to talk about is in verse 7, about hindrances. And again, verse 7 says, but the end of all things is at hand. Be therefore sober and watch unto prayer. By saying the end of all things is at hand, as Mr. Baggage, he's in here somewhere, maybe. There you are. When could that be? When could the end of all things be? Could be now. Could be today. Could be 1,000 years from now. We need to act like it could be any second. We need to make sure that we're doing what God wants for us at every moment, as if he could come back tonight, and he might. We don't know. Hopefully he does, then I don't have to drive home. All right. The second part of that really goes along with a lot of what Joey was saying, was about being sober. Sorry, I'm in the wrong part. So be therefore sober and watch unto prayer. There was a lot of verses that Joey read about partying and drinking too much wine. But soberness is not strictly related to not drinking and not doing drugs. Soberness, let me go to Ephesians chapter 5, verses 18 and 19, where it says, and it does relate here, and be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. So it starts with being drunk, and it gives the opposite, which is be filled with the Spirit. And part of being filled with the Spirit is you should have scripture and songs and psalms come to mind. I know that when I'm tempted, that's usually the first thing that he gives me to help me through the temptation. Now, sometimes I ignore that. But it's really stupid when you say, God, stop bringing that to my mind, because you want to sin. We got to be sober. We got to be in the point where our minds are ready to accept what God has for us. And a lot of things that we do will interfere with that. What we watch, what we spend our time on. Hobbies aren't a bad thing unless they get in the way of doing what God wants you to do. If you're spending all your time crocheting or playing video games or watching TV, those things get in the way of your time with God. Since I've come to Dyer, that's been really a conviction for me that I used to have lots of streaming channels, and now I'm down to very few, because that's what I would do with most of my time, is just spend my time mindlessly watching this series after this series. And a lot of the stuff in those series is stuff that you don't want to feed your mind. It's contrary to the Word of God. And I've really had to pull back on a lot of those things so that I'm not feeding myself something evil and have time to spend time in the Word. And I originally planned on, when I started giving all that stuff, that I was going to read the Bible in 90 days. Well, then Pastor started asking me to talk and do things. And which was actually a better thing, because reading it in 90 days, I wouldn't have got very much out of it. Now I'm reading small portions and really focusing and really going. And I think that's what we definitely need to do, is really don't try to just get through. Try to really understand. And I think that's really important. So the hindrances, what's getting in your way? You know, we all have something. What's getting in your way of doing what God wants you to do? Second part, charity and hospitality, where it says, above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover a multitude of sins. That word could also be translated love. I think we, in our language, we don't really give that word the credit that it deserves. When we think charity, we think, oh, that's giving to the Salvation Army or giving to this or that. And when we think love, we think of some gushy feeling, like my wife has for me. She loves when I use her as an example. I have the same feelings for her. It's okay. but it's more than that. The word here is from Greek. It's agape, and agape is the kind of love that God had for us. It's the unconditional love. It's action. It's not just. I mean, God's love was not, I love you. God's love was, I'm going to die for your sins because it's the only way that you can spend time with me. Huge difference between it's a nice little feeling and what it's really saying here. And hospitality, it says, use hospitality one to another without grudging. So even when it's inconvenient, use hospitality. Right now, there's one of the missionaries is coming into town. And I know Pastor Peters asked for volunteers to host them. And they're probably, unless somebody steps up, they're probably going to stay at my house while I'm in Alaska. I'm going to spend one day with them. I would really love to spend all 7 days that they're here. So if somebody wants to take that, please do. Please be hospitable. Please spend the time, even if it's inconvenient, because I know it's inconvenient. But and if not, they're more than welcome to stay at my house, so I won't be there. But I will spend a day with them, and I'll at least get some time with them. I think that's huge. We've seen both charity and hospitality here since we started coming to Dyer Baptist. We've seen the first week we were here, we were invited to someone's house. Mrs. Gray knew us from school, so it was an easy invite, but there was the hospitality right there. And hugs and glad to have you. A few weeks ago, a couple sat in front of me, brand new, never seen him before, and Kim was working in the nursery. And before I could put my Bible away and say hi to them, they're right in front of me. Before I could put my Bible away, there's three other people already there, so I never even got a chance to say hi to them. So it's happening here. We're showing love. We're exercising hospitality. We just need to make sure that we're really doing what he wants us to do here. And then when we get to verse 10, I was originally thinking this passage was kind of about spiritual gifts, because in verse 10 it says, as every man hath received the gift. It doesn't say spiritual gifts, the gift. The gift that we received is salvation through the blood of Christ. So if any of us have received that, which I hope is all of us, if not, I'd be glad to talk to you afterwards. We'll talk that through and figure out what needs to happen there. But as you have received the gift, in the same manner that you have received the gift, even so minister the same. So be willing to give everything to anybody that needs it. I used to think, and I was brought up, that 10% of my money was God's. I needed a tithe, And then, but that also leads to 90% is mine. That's wrong. It's 100% belongs to God. And we need to give as he's given to us. Sometimes that may be way more than we think we can. And he always seems to find a way to fill that hole, as I've been convicted of what to give. And I look at my budget and say, well, I know you're throwing a number in my head, but that number doesn't work with my budget. He fixes the budget. He figures out ways that I can save some money, or some money comes in, or whatever, when I'm obedient. And sometimes he waits to see, are you going to be faithful on that? And can't outgive God. That's definitely true. And we're stewards of everything that he's given us. So the second part, the duties. What can you do? What's your ministry? Doesn't matter if you're working in the nursery, if you're speaking up here, if you're ushering, if you're just praying behind the scenes and nobody knows about it. Most ministry around here, nobody knows besides you and God and maybe some of the staff around here. But the only person that needs to know is God, that you're doing what he's asking you to do. So whatever he's bringing as your conviction, you know, if he's convicting you to make cookies for next week, step up and make cookies. Even if it's inconvenient. Even if it's inconvenient, because it might be, I don't know if I'll have time to make cookies. I don't know if I'll have time. You don't know if you'll have the next breath. You'll make time for what God wants you to do. So if he's putting that on you, do it. All right? And the reason, the most important part, I'm going to read a couple other verses. So from 1 Corinthians 10:31, it says, "Whether therefore ye eat or drink or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God." And then a verse that has meant a lot to me since I was 12. I learned it at a camp, and I'll read the verse after. It's Colossians 3:23, and I'm also going to read 24. "And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily, as to the Lord and not unto men, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ." And that really ties in very well with the end of chapter 11, "that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever." And I think that was the end of Joey's too. It's all for the glory of God. And that's what we need to do. So the three questions that you should ask yourself: what's in the way? What can or what should I do? And is it glorifying God? And that's it.
Okay, we'll dismiss the children at this time. They can go with Pastor Peter and enjoy their time of fellowship. And we'll continue here with prayer time. And I'll start out with the announcements for this week. Kids Bible Camp starts next Monday. So are we ready? I think the auditorium is. How about the teachers and all the cookies that need to be made? So if you're bringing cookies, you can put them in the kitchen on the counter there or in the freezer if it would be necessary. Mark them for the kids' camp week. Now also, there will be a Bible camp workers meeting this coming Sunday before the evening service. So if you've volunteered to work in the Bible camp that's coming up the following week, meet at 5 o'clock, probably in the teen room, I would imagine. So be sure and be there if you volunteered to work in Bible camp work. We'll have a business meeting Sunday, July 17th. There are four recommendations from the deacons. The first recommendation is to treat and repair the auditorium roof. Second one is to replace the white van. The third is to send a $1,000 gift to the COACs in South Korea to help them with the rent of the building that they're in. And the fourth one is to send $1,000 to the Smiths in Papua New Guinea to help them with the building of their new clinic. If you have questions, especially on the roof, see one of the deacons, ask them some questions, because this is something that the old roof is 30-some years old. We got a few leaks there. Maybe can explain what process we're going to look at to have done. Now, prayer request. Pray again for the Children's Bible Week starting this Monday at what time? 8:45. There we go. We do have some that remember. 8:45. Of course, it wouldn't be difficult or bad for you to be here at 8:30 to get yourself prepared for that. So anywhere between 8:30 to 8:45. Pray that the church can reach the community through this outreach. We have many children that could come under the influence and immersed in God's word through this summer. So we can be a good neighbor in the neighborhood and have some of the kids in the neighborhood, have maybe some of the school kids come. So be out there, maybe invite some that you know that might like to come. So this will be a good opportunity for the younger group. Pray for Veronica Johnson, who was diagnosed with chrome venous insufficiency, which means the veins in her legs collapse while she's standing, which is affecting the blood supply to the heart. She's been wearing compression socks for 3 months. She may have to have surgery if this doesn't work. Also pray for their daughter, Hope, that she'll be able to get back into day school. That's Veronica Johnson. There are a number of expecting mothers in our church family. We ask you to pray that God will watch over these little ones and allow for a healthy delivery. And Mara Crandall is due shortly. Brittany, Katie, and Becky are a little bit later on. Pray for Camp Tamarack as the teenagers, for the teenagers, which is happening the third week in July. We've asked God for safety for our missionary guest speakers that are coming to help in this camp, as well as the Holy Spirit to work on the lives as we preach these words. Now also, pray for Verity Faith, her pulmonary arteries in her lungs, that they will be able to grow in order that she'll be able to have a heart transplant. She has some good days and some bad days over this past week. Unfortunately, she's still on the ventilator. They haven't been able to take her off the ventilator yet, and she is on a feeding tube. Both parents, mother and dad, got to hold her for a while this past week. So also pray that God will help with their medical bills. My wife and I, Linda, asked, boy, can you imagine what their medical bills might be? So pray that God will intervene there and help them with the medical bills. Now also pray for family. Susie, how would you pronounce this family's name that David's working with now? It's D-A-I. Pray for this family. It's a new Chinese family that David Dang has come out and reached out to, and he's working with them. So add this to your list as well, that they would be able to come and visit with us sometime in the very near future.
Dear Lord, we pray for these camps that are coming up next week, Bible camp for the kids. Thank you for all the people that are willing to come out during their busy schedules in the summer and work with these kids. I pray that a lot of these kids would come to know you as their Savior, and that we could be an outreach this summer. Please be with the Johnson family. Please help Mrs. Johnson with her veins and her legs. Please help these socks to work that she's wearing right now. And also pray for Hope, that she'd be able to get back into the day school. We also pray for the expecting mothers in our church. Please be with Mrs. Crandall as hers is coming up soon. Thank you for the safe delivery that the Gollenbecks had. And please continue to help the mothers that are carrying these young ones. Please help Temulac that is coming up in a couple weeks. Please help Pastor Peter and the youth leaders as they're preparing for this. Thank you for all the work that they put into the youth ministries. And also we pray for Verity Faith. Please help her arteries and her lungs to grow and this heart transplant to go well. Thank you for those good days that she's been having. And also we pray during those bad days that she has. Please give her strength. And also we pray for this new family that Mr. Dong has been able to meet. Please help him to be able to be a blessing to them. And please help them that they'd be able to come to our church sometime. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, we do have some praises. We praise the Lord that Jared Bender and Steve Honeysett and the basketball team made it home safely from Florida. I hope the basketball team learned a lot and they'll do 100% win every game. So it's wonderful that they were able to have this opportunity. We give thanks to the Lord for the many functional and safety of our new nursery. Nice, soft carpet. Very nice. Also give thanks for all the new toys. And I'll bet the ones in the nursery this last Sunday enjoyed all the new toys. I see one of the nursery workers shaking her head. She says, yep, they sure enjoyed it. Well, that's good. Now, as Silas alluded to in his prayer, I have a little more information. The Gullenbecks have a new baby, Lee May, born July 5th. She was 7 pounds, 2 ounces, 20 inches long. And at last report, mother and baby are doing fine. So we praise the Lord for this delivery. Look forward to the other ones as they come.
Dear Lord, thank you, Lord, for giving us this day. Lord, thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to come together as believers, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that for keeping the basketball team and Mr. Bender safe. Thank you, Lord, for the safety you've given us on the roads. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity, and I pray that you will help us to apply what we learn to our future basketball games, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the new nursery, Lord, and for what we've done to it, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for giving us the resources, Lord, to renovate this nursery, Lord, and I pray, Lord, that it will be a good help for the little ones in the church, Lord, and thank you, Lord, for the new toys that you've provided us with. And I pray, Lord, that those will be a blessing, Lord. I pray, Lord, thank you, Lord, that the Gollenbeck's baby was healthy, Lord, and thank you, Lord, for the safe delivery, Lord. And I thank you, Lord, that Mrs. Gollenbeck and the baby are doing very well, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you will bless, I pray that you will help us, Lord, as we continue this service, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Okay, now shall we break up into our discussion groups led by your particular Caring Circle deacon? And if you don't know, again, if there's some here that don't know who their deacon is, there's a list back there by the ushers. So if you would care to come and join your